The main message is that genomics have hit clinical medicine. Well, we now can use these magnificent tools that the NCBI has supported through Genbank over the past 25 years, and we're now at the point where we can really apply them to learn more about therapeutics and how they're going to help treat everyday diseases in all of us. It's really very exciting. Well, pressure is an odd word. I would say that we're just taking advantage of the excitement and the scientific opportunity. And I think as scientists, as physicians, as clinicians, when we see the opportunity and we know in our mind how to get from X to Y to Z, then we say, all right, let's go. Let's go for it. And that may be the self-imposed pressure to get there. But if that's the case, well, I'd say that's great. Well, you know, when we develop a strategic plan, which we've done recently in the Heart, Lung, and Blood Institute, we bring in experts from around the world. As an example, when we formulated our strategic plan, we had over 800 scientists come in and advise us. We drafted a plan. We then sent it out to the communities, to patient advocacy groups, to professional organizations. We put it on our website for the public to react to. So indeed, what we do is certainly informed by the public, by their curiosity, what they want to know, and what they want to see coming from this medical research. I keep reminding individuals in my institute that our investment is really taxpayer dollars. We need to keep thinking about our leveraging of taxpayer dollars. How are we going to bring the best return on taxpayer investment in medical research in this country? Well, I'll tell you, it's a tremendous, tremendous resource. When we were formulating the Framingham Share Program, in which we wanted to genotype the 10,000 participants in the Framingham Heart Study, we knew that we had 60 years of clinical information that we had gathered, and we wanted to put the genotypes and the phenotypes together in a common database. Well, simply picked up the phone, called Jim Austell, David Lippman, and said, what do you think, guys? Can we create this database? And they said, sure. And before we knew it, there was dbGaP, Database Genotype and Phenotype, which is now the NIH repository or data set, data bank, for these very, very rich genotype-phenotype data sets. Absolutely. In fact, if you look at dbGaP today, there are data sets from autism, Parkinson's disease, macular degeneration, schizophrenia, diabetes, a number of what we would call common diseases. And that data set is only going to increase with time. It now is our policy here at the NIH that any genome-wide association study funded after January 2008, that data must be deposited into dbGaP. So I would say in 5 years' time, that dbGaP is going to be an enormous data set, and again, available to the public. It sure did. And again, it's this notion that these data sets are so rich and contain so much individual. It's more than a single individual or a group of individuals could ever really analyze over their lifetime. So let's get more minds taking a look at this, and the concept here is that the whole is greater than the sum of the parts. The discoveries, the applications to clinical medicine will only accelerate if we get multiple people working on these data sets.